Hello.
Hi, is this Greg?
Yes, this is.
Greg, hi, it's Janet with Jordy and Jazz. I'm just going to get them. Are you all set up? Jordy and Youth, are you?
Yep, I'm
Youth
fine.
Youth and Jazz, are you all set up and everything?
Mm-hmm.
Can I put you on hold for a couple of minutes?
Sure.
All right, thank you.
Greg, Youth here.
Hey, how you doing?
Okay, yeah, how are you?
All right. Pretty great show last weekend.
Oh, did you catch it yet?
Yes, I did.
Good. And what were your impressions, Mike?
It was amazing to think that you hadn't been in the band for, what was it, 12 years. I mean, it seemed so comfortable and the energy was really there.
Yeah, it felt like, you know, sometimes it doesn't feel like 12 years at all, man. It feels like 2 minutes or something.
There was just such a great vibe, too. I mean, just, I don't know whether it was, you know, the band's energy and the just what night it was and, you know, all the little touches, you know, the fire eater and everything. It just had a real special quality that night, I thought.
Right. Listen, Greg, we're going to put Jazz on the conference line on the other phone.
Okay.
Is that what you want?
Whatever's easier. I mean, I could do you separate, you know, talk to you first and then talk to him.
You want to do that?
Might be easier.
Okay, that makes it easier.
That way, you know, it's afterwards when I'm transcribing it. It's
yeah,
as much of a headache.
Yeah, okay, cool. Okay, that's sorted.
So I guess...
Yeah, no, I tell you, man, I wasn't expecting that response from the audience either. There's so much warmth, you know. I'm used to New York being quite a hard crowd, you know what
mm-hmm.
I mean? Quite, you know, from my experiences before. So I felt there was a real, real... atmosphere there that night.
So you felt that as well from being on the stage.
Definitely, yeah. Yeah, I thought it was a great gig from where we were, but it's difficult for me to sort of be objective because I'm on the stage.
Right.
But I know when I'm enjoying myself, and I certainly enjoyed myself.
So tell me, I mean, how are you finding, you know, everything, you know, being back in the band and kind of being on stage, you know, playing regularly on stage again? How is it for you?
Well, it's physical work, you know, and that's great in a lot of respects. I feel really alive and music comes alive for me. Sometimes I get a bit knocked around physically. And this time it's so different from when I was taught before, because you've got to do all the promotion and all this, you know, it's all much more sort of meet and greets and stuff like that, which I never even heard of them before, you know.
Well, I guess, you know, when you'd originally been in the band, it was a lot, you know. Now you're kind of, it's a different thing. The band is like a legend now, in a way.
It's good, people want to meet us.
Yeah.
Yeah,
You know what I'm saying? Though it's like you've come back to something that's now on in a different sort of lifespan.
Yeah,
you know,
well, I was surprised. That's what I'm saying. I didn't expect that. I thought we would be fairly unknown still here. You know, and I'm amazed at how much people know about the band and how popular the band is. And some of the fans and stuff, and they come up to you and they say, oh, you know, this music's really helped, you know, this means so much to me and all this. You don't see that when you're sitting in the studio.
Right. Well, I think too, a lot of it too is, I mean, I've noticed is that there's more of a buzz about this record. I think it kind of woke up a lot of people who hadn't maybe listened to the band in a while. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, I thought that the last album was pretty good, yeah. and better than the one before it. I wasn't too fond of, but
oh my God,
but you know, even though the last one I thought was pretty good, it really didn't, you know, it didn't really make that big of much of a stir. Whereas it seems like from the moment this one came out, I've just been hearing people talking about it. It seems like there's some kind of, you know, I don't know. Maybe it's
exciting, eh? That's great. That's the first time for us, I think.
Mm.
I mean, that's what Jazz and Jordy have been saying. I mean, all the years they've toured here, they've never had that kind of buzz or support or, you know, interest. They've had a lot of struggle. And they're still getting a lot of struggle as well.
So tell me, give me your impressions of, how the three of you got back together and, you know, exactly what went through your mind.
Well, it wasn't so much of a conscious thing, you know. It was bumped into Geordie in a studio when they were mixing Extremities, popped my head in, and had a little listen. Nothing seemed to stir too much then. Then I went to New Zealand. I was doing the Crowded House album there, and jazz lives there. So I sort of, you know, saw a lot of jazz then, and we had a few chats. And actually, you know, then Virgin were putting a compilation out, and Geordie gave me a bell and asked me what I felt about the artwork and all this. And we started, you know, working together. Well, you know, before we realised it, we were sort of working together again. And then I sort of suggested to them that maybe if they would entertain the idea of me, you know, producing the band. And that was the initial idea, was just to produce it. And then when we got together, you know, it felt like a band, and me in the band sort of thing, and we were writing together. So, you know, that led on to doing a gig, which I was just going to do a couple of gigs. And then that felt so good. And, you know, when you're in a band like Killing Joke, we can't compromise. So what I've done is, you know, stepped aside from all my other commitments, productions and everything, and just dived in.
So it was a very organic kind of coming together.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's like being taken by a wave, you know. And, you know, before you realize it, you're out at sea, you know.
Right.
And I like that. I like that in my life. I don't like an easy life. I like to surrender to what's pulling and pushing sometimes. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I like to go with that. And that's, you know, my intuition tells me it feels right. And it is really good fun. For me, it's been great fun because, you know, I've been locked in studios, man, which again, don't deny. I mean, when I was touring in the early days, I used to dream of being locked in studios, you know. At sound checks, I just think, oh, I wish I was in the studio cutting a track, you know.
Mm.
But after doing that for 10 years, you know, pretty solidly, now I didn't start dreaming of, oh, I wish I was at a sound check, but I started feeling I needed to get a bit more, you know, real sound in my life rather than this controlled environment.
Right.
And you know, I did it in production as well. You go to unusual places and record with, you know, low technology and stuff. Those are challenges, but to actually, you know, step on the stage and, you know, play your instrument, just be a bass player, be a musician again, you know, I made my life very complex, I think, with you know involvement in the label and producing and remixing and doing 100 other things as well. I wanted to get back to the essence of myself musically, and for me that's being a bass player,
right?
And to play live, you know, a wandering minstrel tradition, folk tradition, really.
Mm-hmm.
And I started playing acoustic and writing and singing my own songs a bit as well. And that's kind of an important thing after all the studio technology, to just be able to pick up a guitar and sing someone a vibe of how you feel or whatever, you know. And so I've gone full circle in a lot of ways. I feel like I've, you know, gone through all that learning process with the production to be able to just come back to the simple thing of being a bass player with Killing Joke, and just you know, feel confident about. Excuse me.
Sure. Did you find when you were actually creating the music in the studio that it?
Sorry.
You okay? Did you find that when you were actually in the studio again creating the music, did you find that it was, you know, a different vibe than it was years ago? Was it easier? Was it more difficult? Was there still a lot of creative conflict going on?
Both, you know, the people, we're essentially the same people.
Mm-hmm.
But Jazz and Geordie have been on the road a long time, and I've been in the studio a long time, which, you know, gives us different tolerance levels and things like that, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
But it was with Killing Joke, it was quite, you know, traditional, and there's in as much as it was unexpected and a lot of surprises were coming through that I didn't expect to happen, but I wanted to happen, you know. But I mean, for example, we wrote a lot of material in London, then when we got to New Zealand I started playing it, we threw it all away. Now it was difficult for Jazz and Geordie. The last time they saw me, I was the youngest bass player in the group, and although I got quite involved in the production on the early stuff, my role was a bass player. And it was, this time I was officially the producer.
Right.
And then suddenly, like, well, you're the producer, you know. I was still the bass player, you know, the 17-year-old bass player or whatever. So it took them a little while to sort of begin to trust me. I mean, at first when I suggested we threw away a lot of material, I mean, no producers ever suggested that to them in their life, you know what I mean? Suddenly used them to turns, and, you know, and I think for them, you know, it was probably a bit, you know, more intense than it was for me in a lot of ways. But when we all started hearing the results of it, you know, people started relaxing a bit and becoming more confident and trusting in my decisions and stuff. And the thing is with the band, because we're three piece really now, we don't get into a kind of a two-sided confrontation, you know.
Right.
There's always, you know, one someone's going to be outvoted. But it's not a democracy either, you know, and we don't compromise, and, you know, that makes it intense sometimes, because Jazz won't compromise, and you know, we do get into, confrontational sort of circumstances sometimes. But essentially, we want the same thing, and that's the whole idea, is despite all our differences, we can still work together and come up with something we all feel really,
right,
really 100% happy with, without having any of us compromise. That's the beauty of being in a band, really, when it works.
You mentioned that, you know, it's a really a three-piece now. Who is the drummer who played live with you?
Well, Jeff Dugmore. I mean, he is pretty much in the band.
Let me get the spelling of his name. Jeff or the G?
With a J E F F.
Okay. And the last name is
Dugmore. He's a great drummer, Jeff, and
he was on the record as well.
He's on the record.
Was there any particular thought, you know, choice in terms of him, or?
Well, we started off actually in New Zealand with a couple of drummers that Jazz found down there, and initially we wanted Big Paul to do it, the original drummer, and then sort of 2 days before we start cutting the album, he sort of phones up and starts throwing wobblers, basically. So that didn't happen. So we had to find sort of two drummers quickly, or a drummer quickly. And I tried to cut the tracks with two drummers, and we did.
Mm.
But it didn't. It didn't come out that well. And when I got into mixing it, I needed to replace it quickly, and got hold of Jeff. Jeff sorted me out totally, and we clicked really well.
I noticed that live, the two of you seemed to really work very, very well together. A lot of people noticed that.
Oh, great, really?
Yeah, it seemed like you were definitely conscious of what the other person was doing.
Oh, yeah.
Which isn't always obvious in this sort of music, you know?
Right. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, to me, the rhythm side of it's really essential, you know? And, most of our influence on that side of it's black music, to be honest. But yeah, it clicks with Jeff for me, I don't know how far we're going to take it with him. We just cut some new tracks just before we left with Jeff as well.
So you're already looking towards another record?
Yeah, we've already started recording bits.
Great.
And I don't know, I think it's so different for all of us, this tour and this album, we're not trying to make too many plans for the future, you know, and we're just trying to keep it kind of open and see how we feel, you know, because it is different for Jazz and Geordie having me back in, and it's different for me being back in the band, you know.
Sure.
So, but it's solid, and we're, you know, I'm loving it.
Did you follow the band the years that you were that you were out?
I kept in touch with what was going on. I didn't talk to Jazz personally for 8 years, but I love Like Blood, and you know, some of the stuff of Fire Dancers. I think it started going downhill from that point on, though, unfortunately.
Mm.
Culminating with Outside the Gate, which I won't mention at all.
Yeah, that's the only album by Killing Joke I'm not particularly fond of, but I noticed too that you seemed very comfortable playing Love Like Blood the other night. It sounded really good, even though, I mean, you obviously it wasn't a song you'd been on the original album, but it's you seemed real comfortable with it.
Well, Geordie knows my style really well. Me and Geordie play well together, man. We know each other. We know each other's musical territory very well, you know. And
do you ever find it difficult? I mean, as a guitarist myself, I always am amazed at the totally kind of weird chordal patterns he comes up with sometimes,
yeah,
and the
man.
Tunings. I mean, do you ever find it weird to you know, or you know, how do you find it working with someone whose guitar style is that kind of iconoclastic?
I'll tell you what it is. It's very what it means is when you work with other guitarists, it's very disappointing. Because I haven't worked with another guitarist that comes close to Geordie for inspiration and sound. And he's, you know, he makes his guitar sound like an orchestra, man. I mean, he just gets sounds out of it I've never heard anybody do with a guitar. And it's totally him, you know. And at the same time, you can still see where it's all coming from a lot of the time. You know, he's still quite upfront about it with his style, you know, and what his influence is his culture. And I love that about him. And I love, you know, it's fantastic playing with him.
I think what fascinates me is the idea that he can play things that are so complex, but yet he makes them sound very, very easy to the ear. Like I don't know if I'm explaining it right.
Yeah, no, it's because he's very, very adept at the guitar. That's why.
I mean, it doesn't sound like just wanking or, you know, just lots of complicated noise. It sounds like it has a complexity, but in a way, it's very accessible to the ear.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've always been fascinated by it.
Double helix.
Mm.
Yeah, no, it is beautiful. It is beautiful.
What do you think about, you know, the sound of the new album is like with you and back in the band as compared to, like, what do you think that you've brought through from your years, you know, of production? I mean, obviously some of the stuff is different. Like, I really like Whiteout, and it seems like that is very like.
Well, I think you just have to listen to the last albums they did and this album. I mean, that's the difference, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the last album was good, but it's missing a certain freshness. This album seems to really, it's very revitalized.
To me, what I'm trying to do is bring the band back into the tradition of the first early ideas, which is being, you know, innovative, fresh, you know, honest about what we're listening to,
right,
vital, all those sort of things. And although Extremities was an intense album, it did still sound like, to me, Killing Joke sounding like Killing Joke. You know?
Yes.
And up until the third album, the first two albums didn't. They just sounded like Killing Joke. And to me, this album is the first album since then, really, that really sounds like Killing Joke, because it doesn't sound like Killing Joke. Do you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that's something, and to me, it's like the first album. So I feel, you know, I still don't feel we got as close as I wanted to get to the sound we got. I can hear in my head with the band, but I think we got a lot further than we've ever been before.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like that after the first album as well. So it seems to be, you know, I think the next couple of albums are going to be really powerful. But this one, you know, I still listen to it and love it, and playing it live makes the songs come alive, makes it all very real to me.
Right.
And I go through each one very, you know, through that journey every night now, and I find it very charging. I love it. Yeah.
Do you, you know, I mean, obviously the interest is there, but also in the sense that I think that the band is looked upon now, you know, as a major influence. I'm sure you're getting a lot of questions about that.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you, you know?
I don't think it's ever been better for the band than it is now, because when we first came over here, we were almost ahead, you know, too ahead. People, it was a bit too like, we're not ready for this just yet. But you had a whole generation of people grow up on it.
Right.
And they've listened to it as an underground thing. And so this time people know who the fuck we are, which is amazing. I wasn't prepared for that. And I'm delighted. I'm absolutely, you know, I can't tell you how happy I am that people are aware of Killing Joke in America, and that they're playing Killing Joke on the radio. You know, 50 times a week or something ridiculous. To me, that is, you know, that's great. And the feedback we're getting from the people, from, you know, who are into the music as well, I think we all deserve it, really.
Well, I don't know about that. Are you flattered then by the, you know, all the different covers that seem to be popping up and of your old material?
Well, as a writer, I mean, that's about as far as you can go, I think, when if you make some music that moves someone to the point where they influence their own work by it. I mean, that's affecting real change in someone's consciousness. That's essentially what you're trying to do when you communicate when you express yourself. You know, you're trying to touch people with you know, an essence of yourself, you know. And if it goes to that point where you know, they actually, you know, influence, they want to change their opinion about their guitar sound or whatever, then that is, you know, that's a major, that's a very powerful thing, I think. That's much more powerful than having a number one pop hit.
Right.
Which you'll only see on some nostalgia TV show 20 years later, or on some golden oldie. I mean,
well, I think people aren't looking at you as a nostalgia act, which is great, you know.
Sure, yeah.
You know, that's what's good about the new record. It's not like it's just a band getting back together and not offering something new, or you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
So
it was important for me. That's why we're playing a lot of the new album, and to really make that statement that this isn't, you know, a new force. You know, it's not.
Mm-hmm.
We're not trying to, you know, cash in on our credibility of being influential or something like that. You know, what we're trying to do is, you know, what we've always done, which is do what we want to do. And we're sort of we're getting away with it now, better
right.
than we've ever got away with it.
How do you determine, like I had heard from a friend up in Boston that you've been doing a lot of different kinds of sets in terms of material. Like, how do you choose? Like you said, you want to emphasize the new album. How do you choose what songs you want to play? Because it seemed to me the other night it was mainly like interesting, like based on what you're just saying, a lot of the new album and the first album seemed to me to be a lot of that.
Well, Jazz and Geordie sometimes have a difference of opinion, especially right in the middle of the set. In fact, at the Academy, it went off there, didn't it? Yeah. But it depends what mood we're in, really.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the beauty, is every night, you know, we tune into the energy around us from the place, you know, and the temperature of the weather. All of that is significant, you know, and then the people there, you know, what kind of atmosphere it is, it's a two-way thing, you know. I've got to feed off their vibe to know which way we go. It's a journey, you know, and every night's a different journey.
Mm-hmm.
And you do it together, you know. It's like you all get on a big boat and you go off across the sea, you know, and with each night it's a different crew, different audience, you know, and sometimes you feel that, you know, you gotta go that way round, you know, or this way round or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an exercise in being aware, do you know what I mean?
Sure. You want to be in tune with the current environment you're in.
Heightened.
Mm-hmm.
Makes LSD look trivial. that kind of state of mind. And it's consciousness. And we respond to that, you know. And so that's, you know, that's good. I mean, we don't really see ourselves as sort of, you know, entertainers or things like that in that sense. It is entertainment, sure. I hope they find it entertaining, but I don't see it as entertainment. I see it as us basically being artists, self-expression. When we get up there, we have to be ourselves, you know? And that's more important than doing some kind of routine, formularized show. For me, that would be disrespectful to the audience.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think the audience wants someone up there trying to give them a distraction from the reality of their life. What we're trying to do is make all of our realities at that moment as heightened as we can. So, I mean, essentially, I do it for myself.
Right.
Know? Honest, but when I get, I'm sensitive to that audience, and if I feel a vibe, I'll respond to it, you know, and that's how I see it. And it's a journey for me. It's a ritual for me. It's a release. It's a complete
a cathartic experience.
Yeah. It's a very old tradition. And so I try and keep the showmanship out of it as much as I can, although it may look totally opposite to that to people on stage, because we dress, you know, weird and we jump around or whatever, but that's just because that's how I feel, you know, or that's what we want to do. Yeah, it's not
contrived.
Well, no, it's not contrived. It's consciously done, but it's for our benefit. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
You know, I want to release an energy that is outside of all of us. You know, but you can only do that when you're all together. Do you know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
And. You know, sometimes you've got to.
Well, there's a collective energy.
That's right.
At that point in time.
Yeah. But there's also, you know, there's a lot of energy, not just from the people, but all around. And it's what I want to do is dig that up, and it's, you know, and get that whole thing moving, and get us all outside of that moment for a while, you know, and really just. Go on a journey, you know, and let well, you know, when I'm playing, I, you know, when it's really playing, when it plays itself, and I'm sort of almost, sometimes I sort of hear it, and I can't, you know, it doesn't feel like I'm playing it, you know, so I can be listening to it, you know what I mean, and that's when it's really good, is when it plays itself. You don't think about it, there's no intellect, it's just, You've opened up a tap or something, and there it is. It's like an electronic sinew muscle or something that's invisible, that the music, that you sort of tap into, and the music just takes you with it. And the music is its own thing, as I see it. It has its own spirit as well, you see.
Mm-hmm.
And half of it is allowing that to come through, and when you get that, then, you know, it's a sort of spiral vortex. It pulls everybody in, and eventually the whole idea between the band and the audience dissolves, and you're all just in this totally other dimension of an experience. Sometimes it actually goes silent, it goes so intense. And it, not just me, I mean, the whole, everybody hears it, it sort of goes, it sort of does a double whammy or something, you know? And, you know, that's, I don't, you know, that, it's very hard to explain that shit. In words, you know?
I can understand what you mean. Do you get that same feeling in the studio, or is that something you exclusively feel?
Sure, you do.
I would imagine when you're...
Magnetic tape records that, you know.
When you're mixing, then, do you feel like it's not even so much you consciously choosing things, but something just happening?
Yeah, I release, I surrender to it. I release myself to it. I let it possess me. And that's the thing. You give yourself into it fully, and then it possesses you, and then it does it, and then you follow it. And in the studio, it's a different kind of performance, you know. The audience, you don't see the audience. You don't always see the audience on stage, don't forget, right?
Right.
Because of the lights and stuff, you feel them. And in the studio, sometimes you feel the audience before they've heard the record, you know, before they've heard the thing, you know they're going to hear it. And you can feel that, and you can tune into that as well. And the record will make itself. It's a revealing process, you know. After my production techniques are just setting up an atmosphere that lets that come through.
Right.
You know, that's, and that can just maybe sitting in the room, having a cigarette. You know, it's certainly not about what kind of mic you're putting on the kick drum.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Well, that distinguishes a really interesting producer from, you know, someone who's just technically adept.
Well, I think...
Not that anybody couldn't do it, I'm just saying that some people aren't open to that.
Yeah, maybe, yeah, I think you're right. I think you're right, that's generally a good sign.
Do you find, like, you know, the new material that you've recorded with the band, you know, lends itself, obviously, I mean, like we were saying before, you know, there's a lot more of a dance music influence in this version of Killing Joke. Do you find that lends itself to mixing and doing, you know, remixes and things of that nature, or?
Well, it's a chicken and the egg situation for me. I mean, you could say there's a lot more Killing Joke influence in dance music recently.
That's true.
I mean, to me, we're still doing essentially what we were doing 12 years ago in terms of how I approach it, and I think that's been very influential on a lot of those scenes. For me, you know, those DJs who make that dance techno music, they've been influenced by Killing Joke as well. So to me, it's the same spirit, and that's the beauty with Killing Joke. It's the only band I know of that works in so many diverse ways. I mean, we could work acoustically in a bloody cave and stuff, you know, with three instruments. And I want to get into the stretching those parameters a bit, because we're doing it a little bit on this album, but I was restricted and I didn't want to take it too far too soon, you know, because I knew that even with what we were doing on this album, I thought it might be a bit too much for people to sort of handle at once, because there's so many different landscapes in there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But to me, it all sounds very natural. It doesn't sound collaged or fused or anything like that. It sounds as it is. And that's probably because that's where we are, you know?
Right.
So, you know, it's... to me it's just, like I said, we were doing, you know, disco music in the early 80s and stuff. And
well, yeah, I mean, a lot of that music at the time even was, I mean, I remember going to clubs at the time, and Change here in New York was like a huge dance hit.
Yeah, and Follow the Leader as
yep.
well, and things like that. So, you know, I think the band veered away from that when I left, and it got a lot more on the industrial chip. But yeah, ironically, I moved into the sort of more heavier, hardcore dance production work in the early 80s. And, you know, that and was going in that industrial sort of vibe, which is where we are now, more or less, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, it's true.
But I think, you know, essentially it's a corny thing, but music is music, and it's either good or bad, you know. You either get into it or you don't, you know. And the Killing Joke, I think, is people either get it or they don't. And you know, so when I do see the audience and I can see their faces, sometimes there's a look of confusion, and we're going through these different territories and they're not expecting it. And that's part of the beauty of the band, is to destroy your preconceptions, shatter them, so that, you know, so that when you come out, you know, you start, you know, what you thought something was, you come out completely with a new idea that has a big knock-on effect in the rest of your life.
Right.
And, you know, we try and do that with ourselves, and this album's very much about us challenging ourselves and our questions of, you know, what we want, what we wish, morality, what, you know, questioning our lives, questioning our ethics, everything, you know.
Well, Killing Joke is, I've read a lot of stuff, mainly it's jazz talking, but I would assume for everybody in the band, it's more than just a music group.
Sure, it's a life.
It's a life, you know, an entire package.
It is, definitely. Even when I wasn't in the band, it's like the band have got a big extended family, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody who's been in the band is still very much part of that family, and there's a lot of deep love there for everyone. And you get a fair portion of the, you know, opposite polarity as well.
Well, that's part of, I guess, what makes it interesting.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, it extends to the Orb and even, you know, all the bands from Ministry, Cult, all those bands we feel a kinship to, you know.
You've been affiliated with Alex for a lot longer than even the Orb was together, right?
Well, yeah, Alex worked with the band for 12 years.
Right.
Well, he did a bigger tour of duty than I did, man. Yeah, I mean, those experiences stay with you, you know, I mean...
And you worked with...
We've survived, and we're celebrating that. So far, so good.
Yeah.
And we're looking forward to surviving the next, you know...
So you're looking at this, you know, as pretty much a long-term project, or...?
I don't look at it further than the next day.
Oh, that's good.
To be honest,
But you said you do have new material... in the works.
Yeah, no, we're doing some new stuff. I'm really committed. I mean, everyone's committed to it, but it's an unconditional commitment, which means, you know.
Yeah.
And also, I mean, if it did all stop tomorrow, I don't think any of us would be too upset, to be honest. We're all doing what we want to do, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And we're not doing this because we have to, or because it's the only thing we can do, or anything like that. We're doing this because because we must do it, you know. It is us, and it's something that, you know, goes outside of us as well.
Right.
You know, it's a compulsion.
Well, that's as good as that. That's the best reason to make music.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't always add up to your rational logic. That's why I don't try and make plans or think about it too much. I just get into the experience and try and experience that as much as I can. And I can't tell you how good it is, you know, to be involved in it.
And you feel pretty much satisfied at this point, just concentrating on that. You don't feel the need to go out and do more production work at the moment.
Well, I don't feel the need. I don't feel I've got anything to prove to anyone. I haven't felt that need. I've got a lot of things I want to prove to myself.
Right.
I mean, I don't feel, no, I mean, I feel very proud of the fact that we've got on the way with doing what we do individually and collectively, you know, without compromise and have done it on our own terms.
Right.
And have got as far as we've got. And I think, but that doesn't make it safe. That makes it harder, actually, and that means every day you've got to push yourself to new territories and new challenges, so it don't get too easy, really. Which isn't hard in this band.
All right.
Because none of us seem to want an easy life. But it's very fulfilling. I find it very fulfilling. I find it more fulfilling than anything I've done for a number of years, I must admit.
Oh, that's great.
It's good. But I suppose part of that is the fact that I know, you know, when I've got a day off, I can go and do a remix, and I've got, you know, people are still, you know, asking me to produce them. I'm turning everything down at the moment, but I'm still getting asked. And that's nice, you know what I mean? And I have both.
Yeah, that's true. If anything, it'll make you more in demand, because you'll be busier when you do get around to it.
Well, yeah, maybe. I don't think about that either, actually. I don't think about that either.
Well, why, you know, like you said, you're riding on a wave right now. You might as well just do that and not try to think too much about it.
Yeah, I'll let the wave carry me. I can cope with it. I mean, if you've seen what kind of work we've been doing, the sort of work I've been doing over the last 2 years, the kind of work schedule, man, if someone told me that was what I was going to do, you know, before I did it, I would never do it. I'd say, no way. If someone showed me what my schedule was last year before I did it, and how many records I was going to make, and what we were going to do with this and that. If someone showed me the schedule, when our PA shows us the scheduler next week, I just say, no, don't show it to me, because I'm going to get on a plane home, man. I'm going to go to India or something. You know, because I can't do it. I can deal with it if I don't think about it, and I don't try and analyze it, or, you know, have too many expectations or preconceptions about it.
Right.
I just take it as it is, it's fine. And I find I get a lot more done that way. I concern myself with the moment rather than the future. The future always changes anyways, I find, you know. So if you try and make a plan, you're only going to have to change it and make another plan. Change that, because something else will happen and you have to do another plan, so.
That's true.
So I don't really, I concern myself with the direction. I think, which way is the momentum pulling me or pushing me, you know? And that's what I think of. And then the plans take care of themselves, I find. And, you know, I'm learning that the busier it gets now, actually, the more I stop, you know, thinking about it or worrying about it, or, you know, the easier it is. Yeah.
Well, it's, you know, you haven't been doing it for a while, though, so there has to be, though, a kind of excitement to it for you, like you were saying before.
Oh, it's a thrill, man. It's a buzz.
So it's
buzz, yeah.
You know, that I think carries you even more. Without, sure. You know, you don't even have to think about it that much, because the excitement's there.
Sure, but then there's that, you know, there's, you know, doing, you know, sort of two or three meet and greets and, you know, a dozen interviews, and you just get tired of hearing your own voice, you know what I mean?
Right, that's understandable.
That, I mean, there's that side of it as well. But essentially, like I said, I've been quiet for a number of years, so I've talked for hours now. I've had some great conversations with people I've been hearing. Actually gives me, you know, time to get a bit focused about, you know, an objective about you know, what we're doing anyway. So I'm really enjoying it, you know. And I started to realize that, you know, life's what you make it, really. And you could see that schedule as, oh my God, grueling hell. Or you could think of it as an opportunity, you know what I mean, to sort of have some interesting conversations, express yourself, get yourself focused, you know,
exactly.
Enjoy it. And your perception is down to yourself, really. And in fact, that's the only thing that you can call yourself, is your perception, essentially. And so I'm much more aware of that now than I ever used to be. So I try and utilize that. And that means, basically, you know, to me, that means freedom's in the mind, you know?
Right.
And that doesn't matter where you are, whatever situation you're in, you know, no one can touch you in that. Your perception of that reality is always yours.
Right.
And no one can take that away from you. And I won't let them take it away from me. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And doing this is a great way of, applying that sort of thing, because... Okay, so is that okay for you?
Yep, that's fine.
Great.
So I'll tell them, you know, that I gave you the message.
Right. Oh, look, I've got Jan sitting here now, so
mm-hmm.
I'll pass you on.
Okay.
All right, Greg, nice talking to you.
You too.
Okay.
Okay.
Cheers.
You too.
This is the guy we just had a fire session
with. Oh. Hi, how you doing?
Is this Jazz?
Huh?
How you doing?
Not bad.
Could you hold on 1 second? I just want to switch phones. Hi.
Hi.
So, you've been doing a lot of press?
Oh, understatement of the century.
Youth was saying how, you know, it was like he was shocked at you know, not having been in the band for a while, at the amount of work that goes into the whole promotion of it.
It's massive. It's massive. You've got to learn to everything from waking up sort of quarter of an hour before you do 2 hours, it's a 2 hour set, and your body's so tired, he doesn't even want to stand up, let alone do a 2 hour set, you know. You've got to switch into it, you've got to drink coffee, rub ice all over your body, wake up and tune into the whole thing, then do an interview sometimes. I mean, it's just, it's hard grind, you know. But it's rewarding too.
That's good.
Yeah.
So I was telling youth, I saw the show last weekend here in New York. It was really excellent. And it seemed like there was a really great energy going on there. What were your thoughts about the show and just how the tour is going?
Well, it was a chaotic show simply because we have a set list and the drummer starts on the wrong number, so it was chaotic, you know, live. You didn't know what anyone was going to play next, you know. It was like mad. But I don't have thoughts when I'm on stage. I mean, all thoughts come, but I don't grab onto them. It's like a great gig for me is when I walk on stage and I walk off and I remember very little in between.
Right.
Except for atmospheres, really. Yeah. And I can very rarely see the audience.
So, but you feel them though.
100%. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You feel them, right? Yeah.
Do you find that you know, the shows that they're different now that you're back in the band, or there's a different chemistry going on?
Definitely different.
I mean, it seemed to me that he was playing with the drummer in a very organic way that Raven really wasn't.
No, Raven's no. In terms of feel.
Yeah.
He's got. You know, he doesn't have his own musical identity like Youth, A, and B, it's just the whole groove of the band is different. Well, you know, it's very white when Raven plays with us, but it's a lot more fluid when Youth is with us. I mean, vastly superior, if you want to know what I think.
Yeah, even on the songs that he didn't originally play on, I thought Love Like Blood sounded, Kings and Queens sounded really good with him.
Never ceases to amaze me, Yeast. Never ceases to amaze me.
So, can I get your take on how this reunion came about? I mean, I got his ideas on it, but like, you know, was it something for you that was sort of an organic coming together?
No, it definitely just happened. For me, I hadn't spoken to you for about 9 years.
Right.
10 years. And when we finally met for some ages, it felt like both our work as musicians together and our friendship both were left unresolved, you know. So it went that way, you know.
And when you actually started writing with him, did you find that it flowed pretty naturally again? Or was it kind of...
Oh yeah, no, we've got a chemistry between us. It's really, it's special. There's no two ways about it. I can't say it's the easiest thing in the world when we first started working together again. It's easier now that we've ironed a lot of our differences out. We had like things to resolve, you know.
Right. Did you find it easy or difficult to work with him in a role as a producer as opposed to just a bass player?
Initially, it was difficult to work with him. Never mind that, as a person. Period, right? But no, it's fine. I mean, nothing's changed. All you got to remember is nothing's changed. I mean, when we first started producing our own album back in 1980, you know, Youth Love was different mixes and a different interpretation each song. And so basically what he's doing now is what he's always done. Do you see what I mean?
Sure, sure.
So, no, it's fine. It's good. It's comfortable.
And... you know, you find that the band is working, and you know, as one, very, very,
sure,
very much.
Sure, it is. Yeah,
and that's the impression I got seeing it live.
It's really special. I mean, you know, I am with these guys that I started with when I was 17. And sure, we bitch and we argue, but families do that.
All right. What about the sound of the new record? Is really markedly different than Extremities. I mean, even though I like that album, this one seems to be a lot. It has a real different kind of texture to it.
No comparison, you know. Sure, there's no comparison. I'm glad we did Extremities, but it's nothing to Pandemonium.
Yeah, songs like Whiteout especially have such a different feel than anything you've done in a long time, and anything before really. Did you find that stimulating to do something like, you know, a little different sounding?
Sure, I mean. We remember this album is that we wrote loads of stuff, we got in the studio and we threw every bit of it away, and in 10 days we wrote 10 tracks in my studio in New Zealand and recorded 10 tracks in 10 days, which is the album that we've got.
Right.
There's no real preconception, or you don't know what the hell's going to happen next.
How does that translate to, like you were saying, live? You really have a different set list every night. Is that also part of the fun?
You just don't know what's going to happen the next day. Everything is pretty chaotic with this band.
Well, I'm very much a believer in spontaneity. It's an understatement, right?
Sure, you're forced to this band, very much so.
What did you feel about, in terms of this album, like it seems like a lot of your albums have a certain lyrical theme that they're, you know, a mood that each album is in. This album, you know, obviously it's called, Pandemonium. But what was the overall, you know, groove that you were in terms of writing your lyrics this time?
Again, I don't really, you know, I don't really sort of. The lyrics were written very close together, basically. But you know, I don't know. I've not really thought about it. Give me about a week, and I'll ring you back, and I'll tell you. Again, I don't think about it. I like. Sometimes I write in the bath, I just keep a lyric book on me. And I just try and capture the thoughts that are running through my head.
I like that little speech you gave the other night, you know, about how this is an age of denial, you were saying, and, you know, people denying themselves things, you know, gives them cancer and all that.
Oh,
what were you thinking, you know, about...
The whole thing about exorcism is to let things go. The whole thing about Killing Joke is to let things go. It's catharsis. Or we tap into the roots of rock and roll, which is basically using it to liberate ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Do you find that that's something that, you know, you is an effect that you have on your audience?
Sure, it is, yeah.
Because it seemed like the other night, like, there was such a vibe. Everyone, you know, and even just when this album came out, it seemed like everyone was very excited about it. There was just a real feeling in the air about it. I mean, do you think, you know, that it all ties together somehow?
Sure. It's strange. Strange and wonderful. Feels like the first album.
Mm.
It feels like the first album that we never did, or we've done again. It's a strange thing, you know. I mean, here we are, at the age of 34, 15 years later, getting our best sales and having the best time. You know, it's a strange circumstance.
It's interesting you mentioned that too, because it seemed like live, you concentrated very much on the new album and the first album, and that seemed to, you know, corroborate the...
Sure.
You know, the feeling there.
That's right, yeah. That's right. I mean, that's unconscious, that I know what it's all about. It's just what we feel comfortable with that.
Well, I'd like to get into a little bit of your, you know, your ideas, because I've always found you a pretty fascinating lyricist. You know, just the different, you know, the different feelings you talk about in your songs. And this time, I like the whole millennium motif.
Right.
How do you feel that, you know, the time period that this is right now is affecting that?
It's up to each and every one of us to work out why we're born in this particular period of history.
Mm-hmm.
Where we see the end of the Industrial Revolution and where humanity stands at the crossroads about the direction he goes in terms of whether he destroys the planet or not. I believe the nations that have an industrial-based economy will be on the way out, and those nations that have an agrarian-based economy will thrive. And that's the way things are going, you know. All these thoughts are part of living the millennium, you know, that we, for some reason, it makes everybody feel differently, because when you have, like, a year 2000, we're building ourselves up to this crossroads, and it's appeared in history. Everybody collectively has a sense of history, feels a sense of history.
Right, especially I think more so now than in previous eras. I think there's more of a sense of, you know, history as it's passing.
Sure.
Do you find, like, people look at you as sort of a Renaissance man, sort of in the sense that you do a lot of things that most people would think about doing but don't, like the way you live your life. I mean,
Killing Joke has been a process of demystification for me, you know, that you jump off the cliff and you find out that you can do it too, right? That sort of thing, you know.
I mean, your studies, your travel. I mean, it's, you know, in a way, it's experience, you know. Hunt
sure.
for experience,
yeah,
I guess.
That's right. I get a bit upset when people see in me something that they think that they're not, right? That means they're missing the point with Killing Joke. Yeah. I like it that ultimately, if we're doing our job right as a band, people who come to our shows or meet us should leave with this feeling like, I can do that, you know, in their own medium, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Sure, that's what I think.
I saw something interesting in something else that was written where you were talking about how you felt that, you know, in particular, Killing Joke was a anti-intellectual band.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, how did you, like, do you really feel that way? Or?
Sure, I do. Because the essence of Killing Joke is not thinking, it's going, touching, moving, being, loving, motion, essentially. It's not analysis, you know. We don't even analyze the songs when we write them. We just come together and it explodes. First of all, we live first. We forget about music. We make our lives as colorful as possible. And secondly, we come together. And then the music's already written. It explodes. It implodes. It's just a result of the way we play our lives.
I see. So rather than...
No, what I'm trying to say is there's no analysis. Nothing is planned, really. We have basic plans, but normally they get fucked up.
All right. So rather than the music being the focus of what your life revolves around, the music is a a function of what you do.
The emphasis of Killing Joke is a lifestyle.
Right.
First, and a musical style second.
Do you think most people grasp that, or do you think they just...
Well, I don't believe, A, in democracy, and B, in the majority of opinions, it's irrelevant. I believe very much in a minority.
You mean yourself?
Oh, no, a minority of people,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to a majority. I mean, like, the whole idea of democracy is a joke to me. Here you have this situation where the broad base of the population, the simple, the credulous, determine the destiny of a nation. And they are manipulated by industrial psychologists and everybody else. It's insane. It doesn't make sense.
Mm. Do you think that kind of brings everything down to that level then?
Yeah.
And discourages the kind of, you know, experiences that you're interested in?
I don't actually think that far. I mean, I, you know.
Well, yeah, again, like you said, you're not thinking about it as much.
I've had to define to myself what I believe in.
Mm-hmm. What about, ever since, you know, I was, I guess, a teenager and I was into the first couple albums, and then you went to Iceland, I was always kind of fascinated by your interest in the geomancy. Do you still do that as much, or is that still something you...
Absolutely, I do, yeah. I do it in New Zealand now, of course.
Right.
Sure I do, yeah. To balance the land is essential.
You find that it's important.
At New York, this is an example where the sun's meridian was ignored by the Masonic standards when constructing the architecture in this, and that's why it has more murders per head of population than any other Western city in the world. Geomancy is important. The science of shaping the land to express the natural properties inherent within the land. Geomancy is all important, absolutely.
Well, it's like, I suppose, like the different, you know, some forms of architecture are...
I'm being beckoned to by Janet to wind up this interview, so
okay.
Forgive me.
No problem. Well, is there anything else that you would have to say about, you know, what the band's doing right now, or...?
Well, only that ours is a lifestyle as well as a musical style. Ours is a great tradition. And then when we fly the flag, when we come through a town, and the flag says Killing Joke, it's essentially a consciousness, and we try to tap into other people who are aware of what is going on in their lives, the emphasis being on awareness. And it gives us the privilege to meet other gifted people, and like yourself, and that it's great. I'm very grateful to work with this band.
Well, I'm glad you're doing it again.
I've got to go.
Okay. Well, thank you, Jazz.
Thanks very much.
Okay.
Bye-bye.